Good afternoon. Today I'm going to be talking about using off-the-shelf multimode fibre couplers in combination with a spatial light modulator to perform all optical MDM. I'm going to be doing that over 2 kilometres of standard graded index OM2 grade fibre. Although I'm going to be doing optical MDM, I think the wider point to take away from this talk is actually about how you can use a spatial light modulator to modally characterize components. So the system starts with 2 Gaussian beams, each modulated with its own channel of information. One of those beams passes straight through the beam splitter and goes on to excite the fundamental mode of the fiber. The other beam reflects off the spatial light modulator, which imprints a new phase front onto that beam, which will become the desired higher order mode at the waist of the refocusing lens. And you couple both those into the same fiber, and at the receiving end, you use a standard off-the-shelf multimode fiber coupler to demultiplex them. But first I want to talk about the phase masks used on the spatial light modulator. In most MDM experiments thus far, people have used a few mode fiber, and I've taken a case here of a 6-mode fiber which supports LP01, 11, 02 and 21. And if you wish to excite a particular mode in the fiber, typically people have used a phase mask which takes the form of the desired mode, and they've illuminated that with a Gaussian. And in the case of an LP21 mode, we can see the far field that produces in the middle right there. And you can see it's not exactly an LP21 mode, but it's fairly close. And when you couple that into the few mode fiber, the spatial filtering properties of the fiber itself clean that up for you, and you get a nice pure LP21 excitation as seen on the right there. The problem is, as you move to fibers that support more and more modes, the fiber becomes far less forgiving. So if you try that same technique on, say, a 45 mode fiber, then you can see on the right there that although you're still coupling mostly LP21, there's other modes being excited as well. And that's because as you increase the number of modes, the fiber performs less spatial filtering, and the onus for generating a really high quality mode is shifted back into the plane of the phase mask. You can't rely on the fiber itself to clean it up for you. The phase masks I use are a little bit different, and they use techniques from computational holography to generate a mode which more accurately models the desired modal profile. So as you can see in the middle there, the phase mask still has that same basic four-lobe structure to it, but it's a bit more complicated. But generates a mode which is much more accurate, and when you couple that into the fiber, you get a nice pure LP21 mode. And the trick is, this more complicated mask still has noise power. There's still light that it can't convert into the LP21 mode, just as there is for the simple mask. But whereas the simple mask tends to dump all that noise power directly onto the core of the fiber, exciting unwanted modes, this algorithm scatters the noise power away from the core of the fiber so that it's not going to excite any of those undesired modes. And this is what the phase masks look like. On the left there, that consists of the binary phase pixels of the SLM illuminated with a Gaussian beam, which then produces the far field on the right, which is observed on a camera. Now, as I said, I'm going to be using a multimode fiber coupler to demux the modes. And to start with, I'm just going to plug that fiber coupler directly into the SLM-based mode launch system. So no transmission fiber, just launching modes directly into the coupler. And doing that, you can characterize the modal properties of the fiber coupler. So here, for instance, we have launched an LP01 mode into the coupler. And you see that almost all the power comes out the primary port, and you can't really see anything coming out of the secondary port. When you launch the LP11 mode, you can see that most of the power still exits via the primary port, but there's a rotational variation to it. And as you head to higher and higher order modes, that coupling ratio between the ports becomes more 50-50, but there's still a rotational variation. So what I'm going to do is connect a single mode fiber to the primary port such that the LP01 mode is still free to leave via that port and all other modes will be extinguished, and of course the higher order modes are still able to leave by the second port. So you get a very simple demux whereby LP01 leaves by the primary port and all higher order modes leave by the secondary port. So to put some actual numbers on that, I've taken three different couplers from the same manufacturer, rated at 50-50, 70-30, and 90-10 nominal splitting ratios. But obviously that splitting ratio actually depends on the modes propagating in the fiber. And what I've done is launched each mode one at a time at its optimal orientation along the x-axis and measured the coupling out of the two ports along the y-axis. For the primary port with the single mode fiber attached, we can see that all three couplers perform pretty similarly, and that's because the modal properties are dominated by the single mode fiber attached to the coupler rather than the coupler itself. What's more interesting is the secondary port, which acts as a kind of modal high pass filter where the modal roll off is defined by the nominal splitting ratio. So you can see the 50-50 coupler couple anything to the secondary port that's higher than about the second mode group. 70-30 will couple anything higher than about the fourth mode group, and the 90-10 will couple anything higher than about the sixth or seventh mode group. So the two ports together, our primary port acts like a modal low pass filter, secondary port acts like a modal high pass filter. Taken together, you've got a kind of modal diplexer with a modal guard band between the two ports, which consists of modes to lower order to couple to the secondary port, but to higher order to couple to the primary port. So if you send modal channels either side of that modal guard band will serve to keep them isolated, even in the presence of some modal mixing. To subtract the coupling between the two ports, you can get the modal isolation for a two-channel system. You can see that all the higher order modes perform fairly similarly, quite well, and that's because the single mode fiber is very effective at stripping off the higher order modes. The constraint on the performance is really the fundamental mode. So like how well you can pass the fundamental mode through the coupler without coupling it to the secondary port. And you can see for the 50-50 coupler, there's about 12 dB of isolation. For the 70-30 coupler, there's about 27 dB. And for the 90-10, there's about 31 dB. Now, as I said, this is all in a back-to-back configuration where modes are being launched directly into the multimode fiber coupler. Now, if you add an actual transmission fiber in between, everything's going to get a lot more statistical and it's going to start to vary with time. But luckily, using a spatial light modulator, it's possible to track that modal evolution in time. So for instance, here we have a 50-50 coupler at the end of a 2 kilometer length of OM2 fiber. And you can see that by repeatedly launching the mode at different orientations, you can track the optimal orientation with time. This actually varies fairly slowly in a 2 kilometer length of fiber. This video is playing back at about 15 minutes per second. Sort of more rigorous investigation is this one here, where we've got each of the three fiber couplers, and across the top, it's measuring the modal isolation between the two ports for each of the modes at 16 different orientations. So it's repeatedly launching about 325 phase masks, which correspond with the 25 LP modes at 16 different orientations. At the bottom, it's building up a histogram for each of the couplers, for each mode at its optimal orientation at any point in time. Now there's a lot of information that gets collected in sweeps like these. And I think that's really the wider point to take away from this. You know, I'll be performing all optical MDM in a few slides, but even if for a real MDM system you want to use fixed phase masks or spots or some sort of integrated devices or whatever you choose, it's hard to beat a spatial light modulator in the context of R&D for experimenting and characterizing and measuring modal properties. So, if we're going to perform optical MDM, we've got three couplers to choose from here. The 50-50 coupler only has about 7 dB of isolation for the fundamental mode, and that value is quite variable, so that's not particularly useful to us. The 70-30 looks pretty good. It's got about 19 dB of isolation. 90-10 looks even better. It's got about 27 dB of isolation. Unfortunately, it has that isolation due to the very large modal guard band. And because of that very large modal guard band, you could only use the very highest order modes for transmitting a channel. And unfortunately, those higher order modes have a lot of modal mixing and a lot of modal dispersion, which makes them unusable in the experiments that follow because I'm just using direct detection. So you can see here what I've done is I've launched each mode of the fibre in one at a time at its optimal orientation and measured its impulse response, which is yet another handy thing you can do with an SLM. And you can see that as you head to higher and higher order modes, the impulse response becomes more diffuse, and in the frequency domain you can see that it starts to roll off as well. So that's not much good. So it basically comes down to the 70-30 coupler, which is a good compromise between nice isolation of the fundamental mode and a wide choice of modes to use as a second channel. As it turns out, the best mode to use for the second channel is something in the fourth mode group, so the LP12 and the LP31, which has good impulse response and isolation of about 23 dB. So that's what I'm going to do. Here I've got the input 12.5 gig NRZ signal. And if you just do an overfill launch, which is like a standard way of characterizing the bandwidth of a multimode fiber, you get something like this. Obviously a complete disaster because the fiber's only got about 940 megahertz worth of modal bandwidth. However, if you do MDM and look at the signal out of the fundamental port, you get something like that. And if you look at the secondary port where we're propagating on the fourth mode group, you get the signal like this. And that's it. Thanks very much.